Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The text that I want to emphasize in our message today is from the Romans passage, chapter 11 of Paul's letter to the Romans, verse 29. For the gifts and the calling of God is irrevocable. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Now, how many of us have experienced the end of something? The end of something, the going back from something, the removal of something that we were absolutely assured of was irrevocable. It was irrevocable. This could never again be taken away. This is ours by creed or by a deed or by contract or covenant or whatever it is, cannot be taken away. In short, it was supposed to be permanent. No one was to have the authority or the ability to revoke it. How many of us have been in that kind of situation yet, nonetheless, have felt this sense of something being revoked? I can imagine that the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center in New York City, when they were finished and finally opened up for occupancy, that the architects and the engineers and the city planners of New York City and all like that, they thought, this is going to be a permanent monument to the skyline of New York City, to the financial center of the world. Nothing was going to be able to interrupt this. There would be nothing to destroy it. It is the premier, if you will, monument to the wealth and the power of humankind. And this idea, I would imagine, was somewhat reinforced when in 1993 there was an attempt to bring them down and it failed. They actually let off the bombs, but they didn't bring the buildings down. And so it was even reinforced that this is permanent. Nothing can happen to this. This is going to be there forever. And if you ever watch any films or anything from the mid-80s through the 90s, and they ever show a scene of Manhattan, what do you see there? You know, those twin towers, those twin towers, standing there before all the world saying, we're here and we're here to stay. Right? We're here to stay. And yet, they're not there anymore. They're not there anymore. A monument, another building will be built. But that one was not permanent, was it? It was revoked, in a sense, and rather violently. Perhaps the people of the Ukraine believed, like the people of Georgia, that is Georgia over in Europe, believed some years before that, in fact, their freedom that they had attained so dearly from the former USSR, that freedom was irrevocable. That they had the support of NATO, and they had the support of the United States, and they had support of the European Union, and somehow war was over in Europe, and there was not going to be any way whatsoever they would lose. This was going to be permanent. This had been decreed. This was irrevocable. They were going to be free now. We're going to be free now. And yet we see that their new relationship with Russia was irrevocable, but not really, I guess. I guess not. I guess supposedly, the European Union is not going to rush to their defense. NATO seems somewhat impotent in face of these incursions. And so the aggression continues, it seems. Nothing seems to be permanent. Nothing seems to be irrevocable in our world. Or is it? Is there something that's irrevocable right here in Romans? It says right here, the gift and the calling of God is irrevocable. Friends, there is something that's irrevocable, and that's what I want to talk about today. There is something that cannot and will not be revoked. I ask you, did they stumble? St. Paul says, did they stumble, meaning Israel, so that they might fall? And what does he mean by that? Did they stumble that they might fall? What did he say? What does he mean? In other words, did Israel, who had the covenants and the promises of God that were irrevocable, and they have the gifts of God, which were the prophets and the law and all that wonderful stuff, the worship of the temple and all that, when they stumbled, That is, when they failed to keep that, when they were somehow made weak and were unable to keep all of that, did they fall? And the word for fall means they're falling to destruction. Did they fall so that they couldn't get up? Did they fall, meaning like the world, the trade towers in New York, World Trade Centers, when they fell, they were done. They were done. Is that what happened to Israel? That's what he's asking here. By no means, he says. By no means. I was in a Greek class when I was taking Greek. And there's a particular phrase in Greek, which is usually translated in no way or by no means or something like that. And of course, as you know, I was in seminary first in Texas and then later in St. Louis. And there was a Mexican guy there named Jesus in Greek class. And whenever Jesus came to that phrase and was asked to translate it, he always translated it the same way. No way, Jose. That's how he always translated. No way, Jose. No way, Jose. There's no way that God will allow this to happen because God's gifts and God's call are irrevocable. So Paul is saying here, by no means, no way that this is going to happen. Rather, through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous. In other words, Israel had all these gifts and callings, so they stumbled, so they trespassed, so they refused the words of Christ, of the Christ that God promised them over the ages, the prophet that Moses had promised, Deuteronomy 18. So they let that go. Are they lost forever? He says, by no means, but rather the Gentiles who are now coming to this faith are going to cause a jealousy amongst the Jews, in a sense that they will see, look, all the gifts and callings, they seem to be following those. They seem to be getting those to bring them back. He of course, enlarges this whole idea throughout the entire chapter 11. Salvation has come to the Gentiles, he says. And the question then now remains, has God rejected Israel? And he has said no. God is not. He's not rejected them any more than he's rejected the Muslims or rejected anybody else in the world or all the pagans that existed. Just like he did not reject in the person of his son, Jesus Christ, the Syrophoenician Canaanite woman who came to him and begged for help. Or did he deny the healing of the centurion's servant? And there were no hated people more hated among the Jews of Jesus' day than the Romans. And yet he did not deny healing his son. And it goes on and on. Clearly, clearly, Jesus Christ has come into the world that all the world might be saved. Is it possible that St. Paul had in mind here, even as he talked about this irrevocable call of the Jews, though they had fallen from it, did he have in mind the episode of the Syrophoenician woman? Did he have in mind what we read in the gospel today? Did he think about that? Because what did Jesus say to this woman, in effect? In effect, what did he say to this woman? Look, I've been sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. In other words, I'm the good shepherd of Israel. Am I the good shepherd of this people? No. I have been sent for Israel. Okay? And she said, yes, yes, but please, please help me. And he says, well, how can I give the bread that belongs to the children to dogs? Okay? And that's what the Jews, see, this was a, Jesus was actually insulting her. This is what the Jews referred to as all these pagan people, especially Canaanites, the most pagan people. They were referred to as dogs, and dogs was a very unclean animal to the Jews. They were super unclean. They were just unclean. They were super unclean. Okay, and yet what does she say? But even the dogs, and the word for dogs there is puppies, really, little dogs. Even the puppies eat the crumbs. Even they get crumbs. Do you have a crumb for me? And he said, wow, faith. Yes, woman, it'll be done. As I said, Jesus clearly is operating according to eliciting and rewarding faith. He elicits faith and he gives to faith. And so now, Paul is going to talk about, is this going to be effective in Israel? Well, in the light of verses 30 and 31 of the text, which you have in your bulletin there. Just as you were at one time disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience. And he's talking to the Gentiles here. You Gentiles were once disobedient like that Syrophoenician woman. But you have somehow now received mercy from God by the gospel and receiving the gospel and accepting the gospel that Jesus Christ died for your sins. Okay? And by the disobedience of the Jews, now the gospel has been preached to you. So they too have now been disobedient in order that all, that by the mercy shown to you, they also may have received mercy. In other words, God is now has mercy, and that mercy is going to overflow. You see, the gospel is for everybody. When God's mercy flowed to the Gentiles, it overflowed. And that means it reaches everyone who will receive it. Who will receive it. So what exactly was the disobedience? He talks about a disobedience here. What exactly was the disobedience? How far back do we have to go to figure out what this disobedience was? What did they really disobey in? Were they really disobedient in keeping the law? No, they weren't disobedient in keeping the law. The Pharisees and the Sadducees kept the law. And the Jews, they kept the ceremonial laws. They tried to keep the Orthodox laws concerning food. They kept the laws of the ceremonies and society. They really tried to do this. So was it that they were disobedient to the code? I don't think so. I don't know that was where they were disobedient. How far back do we have to go? We have to go all the way back to the covenant that God made with Abraham. And what was a covenant that God made with Abraham back there in Genesis 12? What was that covenant? Do you remember the covenant that he made back there to them? What did God say to Abraham when he says, I'm going to form you into a people and I'm going to give you a land. I want you to go there, that land. And what did he say he was going to do with Abraham? This is what he says in Genesis 12. And I will make you a great nation. Now the word nation there could be people. I'll make you a great people. And I will bless you and make your name great, the name of Abraham, because he's going to change his name from Abram to Abraham, so that you will be a blessing. Listen to that very carefully. I am going to make you great so that you may be a blessing. Okay. Now, he didn't say, I'm going to make you great so that you may be blessed. That's not what he said. I'm going to make you great, Abraham, so that you will be the most blessed person on earth. No, it's more than what he said. He said, I'm going to make you great so that you might be a blessing. A blessing to what? I will bless all those who bless you. And him who dishonors you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth. Families of the earth mean all those ethnic peoples. All the tribes of the earth. Family and tribe basically mean the same thing. All the tribes of the earth. I will make you to all the tribes of the earth a blessing. They will be blessed because of you. So where was the disobedience? Where was the disobedience that St. Paul is talking about here in Romans of the Jews? What was their disobedience? According to the text, their disobedience was they stopped being a blessing to the world. They only wanted to be a blessing to themselves. And we get a sense of that in John's Gospel when the Sanhedrin meets after the resurrection, after Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. They meet and they say, this isn't getting us anyway. The whole world's going to go after this guy if we don't do something. And the Romans will come and take away our place. Our place. It wasn't their place, it was God's place. And it was God's place for the whole world. What did Jesus do? The first thing Jesus does is in his public ministry in the Gospel of John, what's the first thing Jesus does after making water into wine? Which is really kind of private because that was at a wedding. But the first thing he really did that was out in front of everybody was to cleanse the temple of the money changers and the animals in the court of the Gentiles. And what did he say? You have turned my father's house into a marketplace. You've turned it into a marketplace to make money for yourselves. This temple was not put here so that you could get rich. This temple wasn't put here so that you might have all the blessing. It was put here to bless the world, that the whole world might be blessed. Where was their disobedience? They broke the covenant with Abraham. The covenant with Abraham, and this is why Paul says, who are the children of Abraham? But those who by faith have accepted Christ and understand that the gifts and the call of God in Christ are irrevocable. They had forgotten and were disobedient, and therefore no longer was that temple a temple that was to bless the world, but rather for the aggrandizement of the Jewish elite, if you will, of that time. You see, that's where they were disobedient. They were called to be his special people precisely to bring the whole world into conformity with God's will, which eventually would result in the coming of the Christ and the saving of all mankind. Therefore, we are blessed to be a blessing. We are blessed with the gospel to be a blessing. We were never blessed with the gospel, with the truth of the gospel in Jesus Christ, with the forgiveness of sin and everlasting life, to keep it to ourselves, to hide it in a box. We're to be a light, not put under a bushel. We're to be a city of light of the gospel on a mountaintop, not to be hid. We must be on mission to bring this blessing to the whole world. We're to be a people to bring all people. We're to be a people to bring all people to the one God. And this is what the Israelites were called to do. They were called to bring the Gentiles to the one God. Now, was this happening? Yes, it was happening. Of course it was happening. We can imagine that Nicodemus and Joseph Arimathea and other people of the council, they were very solicitous for trying to bring people into the faith, called proselytes who were come into Judaism. And proselytes came into Judaism from all over the world. And how do we know this? We'll just read the second chapter of Acts of the Apostles. You know all those names we stumble over? They're in the second chapter. All these people from all over the... These were proselytes, many of them. Some were Jews, but many were proselytes. They'd come to believe. Some of the Romans became proselytes, believed in the Jewish faith. Some of the Romans did. Do you follow what I'm saying here? This is what was happening. These were blessed. Was it happening? Yes. But Israel, that wasn't their enterprise as a people at the time of Jesus. But it became the enterprise of the church after Pentecost. That blessing of Pentecost and that proclamation of the gospel is our mission. It is our mission. That's why we were blessed. That's why we were called. That's why we were baptized. Why we were confirmed. That we might give that message to the world, this great gospel of Jesus Christ. Chosen as God's people were the Jews to extend God's kingdom into the whole world. And not by force of sword. It was really by the proclamation of the good news about what God had done in the giving of the law and the giving of the worship and how to please Him. And now it is in what God has done in Jesus Christ. God shows no favoritism. Peter points this out in the 10th chapter of Acts. What happens in the 10th chapter of Acts is Peter is in... He's in Joppa, and he's up on the roof, and he falls asleep. And, of course, he went up on the roof while lunch was being made, right? So if you fall asleep while lunch is being made, and you're hearing, smelling all this stuff wafting up on the terrace, what are you going to be dreaming about? Food! And that's exactly the dream he had. Okay, the sheep comes down from heaven full of all kinds of animals, and a voice from heaven says, you know, kill and eat. Peter says, hold it, I've never eaten anything defiled. I'm like, well... And Jesus said, do not call unclean what God has called clean. Do not call unclean what God has called clean. So, after this little vision, he gets some visitors who have been sent there from Cornelius. Okay? And Cornelius has sent them up here. An angel had come to Cornelius who was a just man, a man really seeking the Lord, a Roman. And this angel said, you go get Peter. So he sends some men up there, and so the men come to Peter and bring him down, and then Peter goes, and Cornelius tells him all about what happened. And when Cornelius tells him what happened, the reason why he was called down there, about what was going on in Cornelius' life when he was in prayer, Peter says this, I know now that God shows no favoritism. Truly I understand that God shows no favoritism, no partiality. But in every nation, everyone who fears Him, that means reverence Him, and does what is right is acceptable to him. And what is right is to believe the gospel. What was right for Cornelius? To believe the angel to send for Peter. What would be right for Cornelius when he heard the gospel? Because Peter preached the gospel. And they all believed. The Holy Spirit fell upon that community there in the household of Cornelius. And they were baptized. And the whole household was made into followers of Christ, received the good news, and were saved. A whole people, if you will, different from the Jewish people, had now become. And do you know that Peter had to defend? He had to defend what he did in Cornelius' house, because it was not lawful to eat with Gentiles. He had to defend that to the Christian Jews in Jerusalem over and over again. He had to defend why he did that. Because somehow, even after the gospel had been given, they still thought it was just for them. But it wasn't. It was for the whole world. And it was because of the whole world. As a matter of fact, many of us, most of us probably in this room are sitting here today as Christians because Paul preached to the Gentiles. Preached to the Gentiles. God shows no partiality. God has a plan. He has a plan for His people. His plan for His people is His plan for His current people. His plan for Israel is His plan for Israel today. The Israel today that has the gospel of Christ. The plan to favor people is the plan to favor people. That's the plan. And so here's something that has always been the irrevocable. This has always been the irrevocable for those who would follow God. Life on mission. Living on a mission. That's what's irrevocable. The gifts and the call are irrevocable. What are the gifts? The gifts are the Word of God. In our case, it's the gift of faith, and it's the gift of Christ in our lives and of the Holy Spirit. These are the gifts, and all the gifts that the Holy Spirit pours out. Those are the gifts. And what is the calling? Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations. What is the calling? Go and preach the good news to all creatures. What is the calling? As the Father has sent me, so now I send you. What is the calling? What is the calling? Wait until you receive the Holy Spirit from on high, and you will be my witnesses beginning in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. That's the call. So we have the gifts, we have the call. And therefore we are to be on mission. Jesus says in John 10, I have other sheep that are not of this sheepfold. I must bring them also, so that there will be one flock and one shepherd. One flock. God meant Abraham to bring all people. All people. Where was Abraham going? When God called him, where did he tell Abraham to go? Go to Canaan. Go to Canaan. And what was Canaan? Canaan was the heart of paganism of that day. They were like PhDs of paganism. I mean, these guys were pagans like you wouldn't believe pagans. And they lived in these fortified cities. Jericho, you know, had huge walls that were many, many, many feet thick. They had to go in there into these cities of these Canaanites who sacrificed children to their idols, who the way in which they worshiped their demon gods was incredible. And what did God say? Abraham, you're going to go down into that land, and that's the land that I'm going to take. You know, God could have called Abraham and said, I'm going to put you on a boat and I'm going to send you to what is known as, nobody knows this yet, but it's going to be called the Amazon. And God said, I'm going to send you to the Amazon. And there's a bunch of, you know, Stone Age people living there, and just tell them about me. And it's going to be pretty peaceful. It's great, you know, all you want to eat. There's plenty of fish. There's nothing you have to worry about. There's no warring, big, huge, fortified. He could have sent them to an easy place. He sent them to one of the roughest places on earth. How much faith did that take? How many of us, raise your hand, if you were given all expense paid trip to the middle of the Sahara Desert? Line up, come on. Or all expense paid trip to Honolulu, Hawaii. I get some hands going up now, see? That's what God did. He called him to go to one of the worst places that you could possibly go to. And said, there's why I'm going to make you a great nation. You see, what God is, do you see how it works? You see how it works? God sends us into the places where it looks like it's not possible to do anything. And suddenly, by his power, his strength, he does it. Like when he called Moses. Moses said, Lord, I can't go. How can I go? How can I go to Pharaoh and talk to Pharaoh about, you know, bringing these people out of Egypt? How can I do that? I'm nothing. And God said, put your hand in your vest. So he put his hand in like that. He said, now take it out. Leprous. Full of lepers. Leprosy. I can just imagine what Moses was thinking. Oh, my goodness. You know. He said, now stick it back in there. Sticks back in, comes back out, is perfectly whole again. He says, you're not going to do it. It's not going to be by your hand that you're going to do it. It'll be by my mighty hand that'll do it. Here's Moses going to the most powerful nation on the planet. And God is saying, you're going to go, you're going to talk to Pharaoh, and guess what? He's going to send 1 million people out of Egypt. And Moses is going, oh yeah, like that's going to happen. You know? And he's using every excuse in the book not to do it. I'm not saying that God's going to send you on an easy mission. Where's his power? Where's his glory if it's easy? It's not easy. It's not easy. Those of us who sit down here and rejoice at what these wonderful women do over there in that learning center, we sit here and rejoice, and we give them a clap, and we appreciate them. You have no idea how hard it is. Did God give them something easy? No. But they stood up to it. And it's by his power, by his hand. That's how it gets done, see? And that's what Paul is saying here. Do you think that the gifts and the call are irrevocable? They're not. They're irrevocable. God will not take them back. He's made it powerful for you to accomplish the things for which he called you to do. He's made it powerful for you to do them. The whole message of this reminds us of God's desire for our fellowship with us. And wants us to be in mission. Because God's call for us is for the whole world. God's blessing for us is for the whole world. And to be a non-missional Christian, is to have distorted the gifts and the calling. To think that your Christian faith is just for you to enjoy. I've got my heaven, now you go get yours. No, it doesn't work that way. We give everything up that we might win some. Just like Paul was willing to give up even his salvation if it would win the Jews. So we give up that we might win some. It's to ignore the irrevocable if we're not on mission. And amongst all those who populate the Christian churches today, non-missional Christians ought to be as rare in the church as six fingers and six toes. That's how rare they ought to be in the church. Non-missional Christians. Those who have no sense that they're to share this wonderful, fantastic good news about Jesus. In whatever your context is, you don't have to go overseas. Some of us have been called to do that. Not everybody's been called to do that. It doesn't mean you have to go to some rough section of the inner city. It doesn't mean you have to do that. If you're called to do it, then you're called to do it. But you don't have to do it. It's a matter of sharing it in your context. Being open about sharing Jesus, especially with those who don't know him. Witnessing Christ, we can refer to it as evangelism, which is really serving non-believers in our mission. It's our purpose. It's our calling. Okay? To not do that is to be disobedient. It's to be disobedient to the call and to the gifts. It's to be disobedient to the irrevocable. But we're not. To do so is, in fact, to be sons and daughters of Abraham, Paul would say. Therefore, brothers and sisters of Christ, amen. Amen. Let that peace of God, therefore, that passes our human understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, even until life everlasting. Amen.